Penguin Random House presents The Big Bull of Dalal Street. How Rakesh Jhunjhunwala Made His Fortune by Neil Borate, Aprajita Sharma, and Aditya Kondawar. Read by Abhishek Sharma. Foreword. Dalal Street is a lane in the Fort area of Mumbai, where the erstwhile Bombay Stock Exchange, now BSE Limited, is located, in Feroz Jiji Bhai Towers, a 29-story skyscraper. Of course, with the advent of technology, the physical location of a stock exchange does not really matter much anymore, given that the buying and selling of stocks happens online and not in the trading ring of what used to be the Bombay Stock Exchange. Nonetheless, the term Dalal Street is really the metonym for the Indian stock market. This, despite the fact that the National Stock Exchange, the bigger of the two exchanges, is located at the Bandra Kurla Complex or BKC in Mumbai. Other than the buying and selling of stocks, something that is intricately linked to the idea of Mumbai is the Hindi film industry. Much of the Hindi film industry is based in and around the western suburbs of Mumbai, quite some distance from Dalal Street. And it's perhaps somewhere in these western suburbs that the writers Saurabh Shukla and Anurag Kashyap penned the rather memorable line, "Mumbai ka King Kaun," for the film Satya. In the fictional world of Satya, the gangster Bhikkhu Mhatre wanted to be king. But in the real world of buying and selling stocks, Rakesh Jhunjhunwala was the king. And unlike the fictional Mhatre, he didn't need to mouth any dialogues to tell the world that he was the king, the big bull of Dalal Street. Whenever he did speak, as he often chose to do, investors latched on to every word that he had to say. But despite the status that Jhunjhunwala had in the Indian stock market and in the minds of Indian investors, there have been next to no attempts made to study him and his investing cycle in some detail. In comparison, there are so many books available on the star American investor Warren Buffett. In fact, a lot has been written about the other big investors, such as George Soros, Jim Rogers, Peter Lynch, Charlie Munger, who was Buffett's investing partner, Bill Ackman, etc. But if you were to log on to Amazon India right now and search for a book on Jhunjhunwala, you are bound to be disappointed in not finding anything good enough to read. Hence, this attempt by Neil, Aprajita, and Aditya is indeed very admirable. It's a big first and a good first. The book does a thorough job of first establishing the human behind the mind and then giving the readers chapters on the stocks that Jhunjhunwala made big money on, including Titan and Crisil. It also elaborates on his investments, such as DHFL, which went wrong. In that sense, the authors try to maintain a sense of balance and don't fall for the quintessential mistake made by Indian investors and stock market gurus of being bullish all the time. Also, it needs to be said here that in a world thriving with attention deficiency, the authors do a good job of keeping the chapters short and simple, without making things simplistic. My favorite chapter in the book is the last one, where the authors tell us what to not learn from Jhunjhunwala. All geniuses have their quirks, as well as their weaknesses. In Jhunjhunwala's case, a quirk was his love for leveraged trading, something that not every ordinary mind is built to handle. On the weakness front, Jhunjhunwala loved to drink, and did so rather unabashedly. As a Delhi-based stockbroker friend of his puts it in the book, and I quote, "He often tried quitting drinking to the extent that he would admit himself to the hospital, where one cannot drink, but all his efforts were in vain. He would go back to his old habits in just 10 to 15 days. Further, as the authors point out, and I quote, the passion and discipline he exercised in the investment world were almost completely absent when it came to his health," unquote. And it's this lack of discipline that ultimately led to Jhunjhunwala dying young in August 2022. To conclude, the authors have rightly focused the book on Jhunjhunwala's investing style and what one can learn from it. Nonetheless, one factor I wish the authors had explored in detail was Jhunjhunwala's habit of equating the success of investing in Indian stocks with the health of the Indian economy, which are two reasonably different things. One can understand that Jhunjhunwala's interest was in driving up the value of his investment portfolio and to ensure that he said what he did. But this is not a distinction that the average retail investor who held on to every word Jhunjhunwala said has the ability to make. All in all, this is a great book for every reader who wants to understand why Rakesh Jhunjhunwala was such a success at doing what he did in the time that he spent in this world. This foreword was written by Vivek Gaul, author of the Easy Money Trilogy and columnist at Mint. Introduction. On 26th of January 2023, the Government of India announced that it would posthumously award the Padma Shri to Rakesh Jhunjhunwala. It was recognition of the fact that Rakesh's life was more than a story of stock market success. It provides a template for millions of Indians who were trying to build their own fortune through investing. Wealth creation from 5,000 rupees that he started with in the late 1980s to 35,000 crore rupees at the time of Rakesh's death stands at the heart of his success story. But there was a lot more to his life than just money-making. First and foremost, his family values and camaraderie with friends and employees. He would credit his father for all the success he achieved in life. He stayed with his parents until their last breaths. He shared a delightful bonding with his wife, Rekha Jhunjhunwala. His first kid, Nishtha, was born in 2004 after 17 years of marriage. Twins, Aryaman and Aryaveer, were born in 2009. His friends meant a lot to him. He wouldn't shy away from sharing his stock ideas to help them make money. His employees loved him. He would give them the freedom to manage his money their way. He wouldn't fuss over losses or boss them around. He would encourage them to take a leap. Second, the stock market guru preferred the limelight. He would willingly communicate with the media and the public and narrate his own story over and over again in a lively manner using colorful language. He wouldn't shy away from voicing his opinions about stocks. He expressed these views even if it made things awkward with fellow celebrities in public discussion forums. His views on Flipkart, expressed on stage with Sachin Bansal present, are emblematic of this. Third, he was blunt to the extent of often being politically incorrect. Pretty women often featured in his anecdotes. "I was sitting at my favorite bar, Jeffrey's. A pretty girl asked if I could suggest a stock that will double in 3 to 4 years. I gave her the address of Mahalakshmi Racecourse," is a story he often narrated. Fourth, there was the relative simplicity of his investing style. Rakesh Jhunjhunwala did not expound some complex investing philosophy. He did not shroud his decision behind jargon or claim to have mastery over financial numbers. He attributed a lot of his success to the nation and the growth of India's economy. This was something that ordinary investors too can also capitalize on. These four features of Rakesh Jhunjhunwala's personality made him relatable to thousands of investors, even as the stock market was attracting a new generation of Indians. He truly was the Pied Piper of the stock market. We couldn't get a chance to meet Rakesh Jhunjhunwala in person. We spoke to as many people as we could, who knew him closely, to narrate his life story. We watched numerous videos of him to compile a first-hand account of what Rakesh Jhunjhunwala would want to tell the new generation of investors. In 16 chapters spread across 3 parts, we have encapsulated his early life, his entry into the stock market, jackpot investments, and how he picked stocks. We have discussed his feelings. We have compiled his learnings to help readers emulate his style of investment. However, one cannot copy one's way to becoming the next Rakesh Jhunjhunwala. Some traits and techniques were unique to him that made him the Rakesh Jhunjhunwala. Even his close coterie would be amazed at the way he would handle his investments. The ease with which he would switch between trading and investing was phenomenal. This confidence cannot be copied. The book will take you through Rakesh Jhunjhunwala's early days as a trader and then his journey from being a trader to an investor, which helped him build his fortune. Flaws are what make us human. Rakesh Jhunjhunwala had his share of flaws. The very discipline in the stock market that made him the king of Dalal Street, the lack of it in his personal life, led to his early demise. This book is our tribute to Rakesh Jhunjhunwala. We hope it helps a new breed of investors learn from the best. Happy reading, says Neil Borate, Aprajita Sharma and Aditya Kondawar. Let's take a look on Rakesh Jhunjhunwala's timeline. In 1985, he starts with approximately 5,000 rupees, borrows money from brother's clients to trade. In 1986, he earns about 25 lakh rupees trading shares such as Tata Power. In 1987, he marries Rekha. In 1968 to 88, he takes leveraged bet on Sesa Goa based on iron ore prices and rupee depreciation. His capital rises to 2 to 2.5 crore. In 1989, he makes a bullish bet on Madhu Dandavate budget. His net worth hits 25 crore. In 1990 to 93, he was initially bullish and then bearish on the Harshad Mehta market, successfully times his trades in both directions. From 1993 to 97, market trades flat. Rakesh does not make significant money. From 1997 to 2000, dot-com boom. Rakesh misses the TMT or telecom media and tech boom in India. 2001, 9/11 attacks take place. Rakesh shrugs off worries. 2002-2003, Rakesh makes a game-changing, long-term bullish call on India, buys a big stake in Titan. 2004-2007, Rakesh rides the bull run with stocks like Titan, Lupin, and Crisil. 2004, Rakesh's daughter Nishtha born. 2008, global financial crisis hits. Rakesh's portfolio suffers, but he survives the storm. 2009, Rakesh's twins, Aryaman and Aryaveer born. 2010, IPO of A to Z Maintenance, a company he invested in, flops. Rakesh's image takes a beating. 2014, Modi victory in election. Rakesh turns bullish, joining the overall market wave. 2018-20, Rakesh makes mistakes on stocks like DHFL. 2020, Rakesh briefly turns bearish in first COVID-19 wave, quickly reverses his position. 2021-22, focuses on investment in the unlisted airline, Akasa. 14th of August, 2022, Rakesh Jhunjhunwala passes away. Net worth estimated at Rs. 35,000 crore. Part 1. The Early Years. In this part, we give you a glimpse into Rakesh's early life and how he entered the stock market. We cover his initial days on Dalal Street when he was one among many and how he rose to the top to become the one and only. We introduce you to Rakesh Jhunjhunwala as a family man and as a friend. Chapter 1. A Chubby Boy. A sweet, chubby little boy who was very intelligent. Rakesh Jhunjhunwala's older brother, Rajesh Jhunjhunwala, described the younger Jhunjhunwala thus in an interview to Udayan Mukherjee of CNBC TV 18 on Rakesh Jhunjhunwala's 50th birthday. "He is the baby of the family," he said. Rakesh Jhunjhunwala was born in Hyderabad on 5th of July 1960. His father was an Indian Revenue Service officer posted in Hyderabad. At the age of two, Jhunjhunwala's father shifted to Mumbai and Rakesh spent the rest of his life in India's financial capital. The Jhunjhunwala family was an Agarwal family with a strong Marwari business ethos, and Rakesh's father took an interest in the stock market despite his steady career as a civil servant. This was unusual. In the pre-liberalization era, very few Indians invested in the stock market, with land and gold being the dominant asset classes. In later interviews, Rakesh recounted asking his father why the prices of stocks went up and down. "Look up news about Gwalior Rayon or Grasim. See what happens to the stock price the next day," his father would tell him. There was a book released by the International Labour Organization, or ILO, aimed at teaching laypersons how to read company accounts, which Rakesh read at a young age. "After that, I began reading balance sheets," he told an audience at the Young Indians Youth Conclave in Mumbai in 2014. Rakesh studied at Sydenham College in Mumbai and later qualified to be a chartered accountant. "My father told me to become a chartered accountant because if the stock market career doesn't work out, a CA practice will give a steady income," Rakesh added at the same event. Chartered accountancy typically involves an extended internship period. "At the end of it, we become shattered accountants," Rakesh said with a chuckle. "You work for 3 years for 60 to 80 to 100 rupees a month. Our seniors would not even give us tea. We would have to pay for the tea," he said. "Our conveyance cost was 80 rupees. We would make it 150 rupees. We could get the extra 70 rupees minus TDS and we would use this for drinks 4 times a month, he recounted, reveling at his little arrangement. Rakesh's father was ambivalent about his son's chosen career. He told Rakesh not to expect his father to give him any money for stock market investing, but allowed him to stay in the parental home. "If I didn't go into the stock market, I would have become either a pilot or a journalist," Rakesh would later recount.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.